Jobs for a feature from Epictasticness for his reviews. We're talking movies, TV, and music. And I am giving you guys a usual annual review catch-up of movies that I've seen. So far this year, I have seen at least 114 new films. It's been more than that if you count older films, but I've been doing a lot of movie watching. And I have noticed that I've missed some things that I haven't reviewed, and usually I don't review them all separately as much as I used to back in the day. But I'd rather do more of a catch-up review roundup to balance this out. So, there's been quite a lot of stuff that's came from January to now that I have yet to review. So I'm going to split this massive catch-up review into two parts. This part, you're going to get at least 11 movies. And then the next part, you're going to get the other 11 or 12 set of movies that I have yet to review. And then there are some movies like, of course, Moxie, and others that I have not included in this catch-up review roundup, mainly because I want to do those as little quick mini reviews or quick movie reviews or such. And this would be a good way for me to catch up and hopefully give you guys each of my opinions on each one of these films. So with that being said, time codes will be blown, and we're going to start off with Willy's Wonderland. With Willy's Wonderland was directed by Kevin Lewis, stars Nicolas Cage, Emily Tosta, Kelly Cohen, and Jonathan Mercedes and Beth Grant. When his car breaks down, a quiet loner agrees to clean the abandoned family fun center in exchange for repairs. He soon finds himself raging war against possessed animatronic mascots while trapped inside Willy's Wonderland. This was the most fun that I had. I saw the trailers for this and I thought this looked absolutely goofy, but at the same time, this also looked a lot of fun. Nicolas Cage, of course, he is a great actor. He does a lot of movies that are crazy and wacky. Part of those things that we do is pay off his debts, But he put that aside, but he does it in a way because he is a great actor, and no matter how good, how bad, or mediocre a movie is, he can always try to be either one of those things. And Willy's Wonderland, this was a fun little film that I thought had a lot more wackiness to it, but it also had a lot more craziness to it. Of course, Nicolas Cage, he doesn't have a lot of dialogue in the movie. He's very quiet through the movie. I don't think he even says one line of dialogue here. But he does a really good job in the role that he is offered to do as this quiet loner who gets himself caught in this very sticky situation for 88 minutes. The budget of the movie is $5 million, so it looks very good for a small budget, cinematography-wise by David Newber, and editing-wise with a lot of Ryan Liebert. This is a very well-edited film. It's very short, very fast-paced, and it's very quick. And even the music and the lighting and the costume designs is also really very intriguing and very interesting. So I very much enjoy that part. And onto that, you have the rest of the cast, which includes Emily Tosta, Rick Reitz, and Chris Warner, and Kadlec, which I thought they all did a good job as well, of course. And Caylee Cohen is also very full in the movie, so she does a good job in her role. My thing when it comes to the negatives when it comes to this movie is that you don't really get to know anybody besides one of these characters in this group, and Nicolas Cage. Some of the other characters, they're basically just there for a screen time to get killed off. And the animatronics, they can be a little goofy, and this whole movie can also be a little goofy. And it does get into a point of a little absurdity, because it just gets there and it knows exactly what it's going for, and it appreciates what it's going for. And one of the negatives that I do have is that I do say the movie, while I appreciate it was a little quick, I will say I do feel like the movie could at least been a little bit more longer because I was having fun with it. But at the end of the day, Willy's Wonderland made it for one of the biggest surprises of 2021. I enjoyed myself for the most part. It was fun. It was entertaining. It knew what it was. It didn't try to go into something or not. So if you're definitely into the whole campy but goofy side of movies, I would suggest giving this a shot. Of course, not everyone will like this. I have seen some people who like it, and of course I would like to see more of this. This is actually kind of cool that I would like to see a possible sequel or something. So Willy's Wonderland, I had a fun time with it, and in my rating system I'm definitely gonna give this. I highly recommend it. I had a lot of fun with it. Batman Soul the Dragon, while it wasn't bad, I just found this to be okay-ish for the first superhero movie of the year. In the 1970s, a missing martial arts teacher is the subject of a quest by Batman and his former classmates. This was directed by Sam Liu, written by Jeremy Adams, and stars David Giuntoli, Mark Dacascos, Keaylee Hugh, Michael J. White, and Jamie Chung. This was a movie that I thought it looked visually good, and it looked visually stunning from the animation. You do have some nice martial arts work here in animation style. And for this being the 40th movie in the DC animated universe, I will say this is a better DC animated film than Injustice, if you catch my drift. And it is based on the original story that's not based on any comics, so I definitely can give you the credit for that. And along with the great visual style and animation here, that's great. I will say the performances from each of the cast is great. I like to get David Giuntoli as Batman, Mark Dacascos as Red Dragon, Michael J. White did a good job as Bronze Tiger. You also had James Hong as Osensei, Jamie Chung as Jay Nguyen, Josh Keaton as Jeffrey Burr, and Keaylee Hugh as Lady Shiva. And the musical score and direction-wise and the writing-wise, I thought was very entertaining. My main issue that I do have with this and why this is not my favorite superhero movie of the year is because I feel like it does go into the territory of being a little bit too crazy and a little bit too so good. Again, I appreciate the fact that this was something different, but I feel like it just got way too overdone in some spots. Also, some of the characters here aren't the most fleshed out, but I enjoyed some of the newer additions that they were going for. Again, I just felt like there were some things that they could have fleshed more upon of, and give us a little bit more time with this, because that's the thing with DC and Marvel and their animated and live action stuff. Some of their live action movies are too long, some of their animated stuff is too short. That's a little bit of a thing with them, and I feel like if this was at least a little bit longer, at least 102 minutes, then I feel like you would have fully fleshed this out. But I loved a lot of the things in here, like the voice animation, and Bronze Tiger was a lot of fun, and I just enjoyed the movie for the most part. While it is definitely one of my lesser favorite animated films, I will say it was definitely better than Injustice, and it was an entertaining film that I enjoyed. It wasn't the best movie in the world, but it could have been a hell of a lot worse. But all in all, I did enjoy Batman Soul of the Dragon to a certain degree. It was fun. We watched this again for background noise, and I was entertaining for the most part, so I'm willing to give this one a stream. This thing, you can stream it on Netflix or HBO Max because they do have it. Flora and Ulysses was another movie that I actually thought was very decent. This was directed by Lena Khan and was based on the book of the same name by Kate DiCamillo, stars Matilda Lawler, Allison Hannigan, and Ben Schwartz. And imagine if a creative senior or cynic never could have predicted that her little squirrel would be born anew as a superhero and have the uncanny knack for helping her and the lovable but broken people in her life. this was a movie that I just rolled my eyes at from the trailers, because Disney Plus, I've been enjoying a lot of their stuff, especially their MCU shows like WandaVision, The Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Hopefully Hawkeye doesn't let me down with that streak. But a lot of the original movies I've enjoyed, but this had me like, really, this is not very good. But looking at this, I actually surprisingly like this movie. First off, I will say the performances in this movie are very good. Matilda Lawler as the main character, I thought was very funny. Allison Hannigan did a great job as her mom. I also very much like Ben Schwartz in his role. I thought he was very entertaining. The rest of the cast, including Anna DeVere Smith, Danny Pudi, and Kate Micucci, they all did a very good job in their roles too. The movie is an hour and 35 minutes to get you straight in and straight out. I love the bond that we have with Flora and Ulysses, and you see, of course, that they are doing very good, and I was very much loving exactly what this movie was going for. It's fun, it's very light, and it has a sense of charm to it. I didn't think a movie with a little girl and squirrels would actually be interesting, but it became interesting, and I was actually very much appreciative of what this movie was doing. I will also say the animation, the vocal effects on the character is very entertaining. I very much like it's very well done. It has a very light direction, a very light tone to it. The only real issue I will say when it comes to this movie is that I think this movie, it definitely does suffer from the syndrome of not having the most fleshed out characters. And yes, this is something we've kind of seen before. And of course, it does go into the predictable side of things, but I appreciated the little twist and family-friendly diversion, of course, on the superhero genre. And it was trying to be something fun, trying to be something creative, trying to be something interesting. So I do have to give this movie the appreciation for that, and the appreciation for actually wanting to try and make an effort. And to his credit, Flora and Ulysses was definitely one of the better surprises of the year. It definitely knew what it was. I have fun with the performances, I have fun with the humor, I laughed a lot. There were some things that, and it was surprisingly very heartfelt. So it definitely had that to it, and I did enjoy this. And this is one Disney Plus movie I would love to watch again, because it's so heartfelt, so entertaining, and above all, most importantly, a lot of fun. So I can say you definitely highly recommend this, of course. Concrete Cowboy, however, was one of the little disappointments, but it wasn't a complete bad movie. It's not even a bad movie at all. I just felt like this one here, I did wish there was a little more to chew off of this movie besides some of the great things. But this is also produced by Lee Daniels, and we'll get to another movie that he did. Sent to live with his estranged father for the summer, a rebellious teenager finds kinship in the tight-knit Philadelphia community of black cowboys with his father. This is a western drama film, of course, based on a novel of the same name, and it was directed by Ricky Staub, and stars, of course, Idris Elba, Caleb McLaughlin as his son, Gerald Jarrell and Brian Bowers, Lorraine Toussaint, and Method Man. Here's what I can say great about the movie. Of course, I will say Caleb McLaughlin as a lead character, I thought he was very good in the movie, and he has to show a lot of vulnerability and a lot of emotion, especially in the vulnerability side of things. And I thought his performance was also really, really great. Idris Elba, of course, very good actor, despite him being a little overexposed. But I will say Idris Elba, he does a very good job in his performance. He has some great scenes with Kevin McLaughlin, and I bought their chemistry. And the father and son aspect is what I really loved about this movie. I really love the father and son aspect of it. This is also a very well shot film, a very well lit film, and a very well edited film. There is one scene in particular involving Caylee McLaughlin and Idris Elba, which I was basically like, this is great emotion. And it does have a heart to it, a sense of heart to it. And when you do get the Western fun, it is Western fun. However, when it gets to the rest of the movie, however, I will say this movie is a little long-winded. It is an hour and 51 minutes. I think this movie could easily be an hour and 43 minutes. And there was also some other characters here that I thought, while they were great, I felt like we didn't get much attachment to them. I felt like that they didn't get as much as I felt like they should have. And of course, there is some heavy drama here, which is definitely something to expect when it comes to this type of movie, and it does go for it. And so I do have to give credit to that, but I felt like there was quite a few moments where I felt like it became too much. You also have this romance, of course, when it comes to, but I felt like it wasn't really there. And it just kind of didn't really go in the ways that it should have. And of course, I will say that there are some moments in this movie where I did feel like it felt predictable. But I did like the old-fashioned uplift with the story that you get. This is an uplifting story, of course, with a little scene corner of American culture. It definitely does have its issues, of course, but I didn't think this is as bad as people made it out to be. I thought the movie, for the most part, it did fine with what it set out to do. I did just feel like there was a little bit more there. But it is definitely one of the more decent films that Netflix has done. I will watch this again. This for Black History Month. It is a good movie to watch for Black cinemas because it's not a bad movie. And with a great cast like this, especially to see Caylee McLaughlin in the lead role besides Stranger Things, I think it does great, and I will definitely be interested to see him as Miles Morales or something. But as for Concrete Cowboy, I did enjoy this enough to where I could say I didn't hate it. So I will say you could highly recommend watching this. Yesterday was a lot of fun. Another movie where I rolled my eyes and saw this trailer, and I was like, no, this is too much. Come on, what are we doing? But I should have. This is what happens when you are not supposed to judge a book by its cover. This is based on the book of the same name, directed by Miguel Arreda, starring Jennifer Garner, Edgar Ramirez, and Jenna Ortega. And simple plots. Always feel like they have to say no to their kids. Allison and Carlos decide to give their three kids a yes day, during which the kids have 24 hours to make the rules. This is a very intriguing idea if you can definitely think about it. I actually really surprisingly enjoyed this. I had a good time with this. I thought this was a lot of fun. It was very intriguing, very entertaining. It's a good old family fun kids movie, and it knew exactly what it wanted to be. It wasn't trying to be anything deep and compelling. It wasn't trying to be the greatest movie ever, especially the greatest family film ever. Is this definitely one of the best family film movies? Yeah, this is definitely one of the best family film movies. Seeing the kids say yes to everything, and the parents saying yes to everything they do. You have some great humor, some great fun moments. I very much loved the comedy aspect of it. It was a lot of entertaining. And I was enjoying this movie for what this movie was giving us. It knew exactly what it was trying to do. And I felt the movie did its job very well. It didn't need to be all preachy and sappy. You just need to have a fun movie with the kids. that kids can sit down and enjoy. I also very much love the performances around Jennifer Garner and Edgar Romero as the married couple. Jennifer Garner is one of my favorite actresses. She's very underrated, and she does this role. And there is one scene in this movie where she kind of has this whole Harley Quinn look to her, which I thought was very fun and very cool. Nice reference to Harley Quinn. Edgar Ramirez, I thought he was pretty good as well. I loved three kids, of course, Jenna Ortega, Megan Stotts, and Julian Lerner. They all did a very good job as the kids. Direction and cinematography wise and writing wise, it's a very serviceable, family friendly film, and it is 86 minutes long, so it is very short, it's very quick, and it gets straight to the point. Yes, it does have its cliche moments, and it does have its moments of predictability, but I will say yesterday, this did try a lot more than I thought it was going to be, and this was actually one of the bigger surprising movies that definitely was actually very well done. It was actually very surprising, and I enjoyed myself for the most part. It is entertaining. I thought it definitely was one of the biggest surprises Netflix has done. That's the thing with Netflix, you never know what surprises they're gonna come at you with. Of course, it definitely has its issues, but I think the idea works. I love the family friendly aspects. I very much enjoyed a lot of the things this movie has to offer. And if you definitely have kids, and if you're in the mood for a definitely family-friendly film, check it out on Netflix. It's on Netflix right now. You won't regret it. I definitely want to see more family-friendly movies like this in 2022 and more. So, with that being said, I'm going to give Yesterday a highly recommended. The Courier, of course, stars Benedict Cumberbatch and Jesse Buckley. This was a movie that is directed by Dominic Cook, written by Tom O'Connor, and in this movie, this is the true story of a British businessman unwittingly recruited into one of the greatest international conflicts in history, forming an unlikely partnership with a Soviet officer, hoping to prevent a nuclear confrontation. The two men work together to provide the crucial intelligence used to defuse the Cuban Missile Crisis. The Courier was actually very good. I actually really liked this film. This was, of course, a 2020 film, but this didn't get a release until March 19th of 2021. And this movie was actually very well done. Of course, definitely when you go into a movie like this, I'm always a sucker for stuff like this, about true stories, historical dramas, about this type of stuff, and I'm into it. And I will say that this is directed very well by Dominic Cook. It's a very well directed film. It definitely goes for what you expect a movie like this to go for. It knows what it is. It doesn't try to be anything deep or compelling. It just wants to be a fun, entertaining movie. And for the most part, it definitely succeeds in that. Top on that, you have some good dialogue and some great scenes with these characters here. You get to see how these two businessmen work and try to stop this little nuclear program bomb during the Cold War. It's very propulsive, very compelling. I thought the performances are really great by Benedict Cumberbatch and Romero Nendison. And they do a great job in the roles. Also, you have the rest of the cast like Angus Wright and Rachel Brosnahan and Jesse Buckley. I thought they all did a very good job as well. It's a very good looking movie, very composed, musically wise film, and edited very well too. And by the end of the movie, I walked away with having some entertaining factor to it. It's definitely an entertaining movie that is definitely one of the more underappreciated films. It's good to see Benedict Cumberbatch in stuff like Doctor Strange and Star Trek in the Darkness, but when he's doing movies like this or smaller films, he's always on top of his game. And Benedict Cumberbatch is one of my favorite actors. No reason why he got that Oscar nomination for The Imitation Game. No denying why. I will say the only issue I do have is, of course, there are some actors in here that are a little on the underutilized side, and not everything is entirely correct. But that's the thing when it comes to these historical film dramas. Sometimes you gotta change stuff in order to make this movie good or bad. In the worst case, as long as you don't go into a Pearl Harbor scenario, which you should be a-okay. But also, I will say the movie does go on for a little bit too long. It is 1 hour and 51 minutes, so it does go on for a little bit too long. And there are some parts where it's great dialogue, but it is kind of exposition heavy. But it's not like most movies where it's just a lot of talking and nothing's happening. There are interesting things happening. You get to see archival footage of the nuclear bombs and such. And The Courier, definitely one of the more underrated films that no one's talking about. I love the performances, I love the direction, and this is actually one of the more better films that people should be seeing. So, with that being said, I'm gonna give The Courier an epitastic. When it comes to the United States versus Billie Holiday, this is a movie where I don't hate it like a lot of people do. In fact, I do think it's actually fairly decent for another directing attempt from Lee Daniels. But I do feel like this is his weakest directed film. But let's get into the United States vs. Billie Holiday. This stars Andre Day, of course, as Billie Holiday, and tells the story of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics as they launch an undercover sting operation against jazz singer Billie Holiday. This is actually based on true events, of course, and this movie, of course, this is a movie that I felt, when it first was announced in 2020, I was actually very excited to see it. It was supposed to come out in theaters in November 2020 and 2021, but with the constant delays and stuff, this movie definitely has to go straight to streaming. It's the Hulu, and this is what I will say about it. This is a very well directed film. Lee Daniels definitely knows exactly what how to make a great film. And Lee Daniels is a very well directed film, is a very well shot film, is a very well acted film too. Andra Day, for her first movie, she did a great job. You also have Trevante Rhodes, Natasha Lyonne, Garrett Hedlund, even some people that he's worked with before on Star, like Miss Lawrence, and you have Evan Ross and Sam Williams, and you have people like Tyler James Williams as Lester Young. So I think acting-wise all the way around, this is very good. And Andra Day does commit fully to this character. She commits. She fits this character, this real life person, and she is fantastic in the role. And I will say, when you do get into things about this story, this movie doesn't hold back. And for 2 hours and 10 minutes, I was interested, I was intrigued with this idea. However, when it does come into the writing side of things, this is where I feel like the script kind of doesn't meet this movie's potential. There are some moments where I think some of the dialogue in here is a little too over the top and a little bit too stilted and cliche, and that definitely doesn't help when you're making a movie about Billie Holiday and you feel like this should be more than just cliche dialogue hour. This should be the picture you've ever seen. Also, there are some things that they just kind of changed for story purposes, and it definitely does show in this. It definitely does show. It's not as bad as stuff like Pearl Harbor, or it's not offensive, but I feel like there are some changes that I made here. I feel like they should have thought twice about, and there are some other actors in this movie I felt are completely underutilized for the most part. put on top of that, as far as more positives go, I will say the costume design, the makeup and the production design, and the look and feel of the 1930s definitely is there. It does feel like you're in this environment. And for the most part, it does go into the route of doing what it's out to do for a Billie Holiday epic, biopic film. And for the most part, I was intrigued. But at the end of the day, I felt like if the script had a little bit more rewrites, at least one more rewrite, and some of the dialogue, and the movie could have been at least trimmed down a little bit because too long, then I felt this could have been fine, a great film. But as it stands, I will say this is a highly recommended film. It's not one of the worst things ever. It's just not my favorite Lee Daniels film. But I am pulling through for Lee Daniels. He is one of the best. And I do hope he gets to make that Star movie, so us Star fans could get a satisfying conclusion to the series that we truly deserve. The Map of Tiny Perfect Things was another movie that I saw on Valentine's Day month, but I didn't even review. I had plans to make a standalone full review for this, but I just didn't have the time to do it or what. This is directed by Ian Samuels from a script written by Lev Grossman based on his short story. It stars Catherine Newton and Kyle Allen. Of course, this tells the story of two teens who live the same day repeatedly, enabling them to create the titular map. This was a romance movie sci-fi thriller in a decade and a time where we're seeing so many movies that goes into time loops thanks to stuff like Edge of Tomorrow and Happy Death Day and such. It was good to see what this romance side of this would do. And of course, this is a very entertaining, very surprising, very sweet kind of movie that premiered on Amazon Prime Video. Easily the best thing I can say about this is the chemistry between two leads, Catherine Newton and Kyle Allen. Kyle Allen, I've never seen him in anything before, so it was great seeing him here, and he did a very good job here. I also very much love Catherine Newton as the female lead. Catherine Newton is a great actress, and I am very happy that she's going to be taking over for Emma Furman in Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania in 2023. This has definitely one of the best performances I've seen of her. She's charismatic and she has great chemistry with our main actor. You could tell the love and emotion that they do a great job. And I very much love the performances of these two characters. You also have other actors like Jermaine Harris and Anna McCamey and Josh Hamilton. They all do a very good job in their roles as well. You have this great moment when it comes to the time loop journey and the heartfelt charm that this movie comes in. They go on multiple time loops throughout the movie. It's very fun, it's very lighthearted, it's very endearing, and it's very sweet. And the messages that this movie tries to get across to find something worth chasing for during this time loop is very sweet and is very endearing. And I found myself very engaged and very endeared with this movie. It's very sweet, it's very charismatic. I like the premise that they're going for. It is fairly familiar to things we've seen before, like Groundhog Day, Happy Death Day, Edge of Tomorrow, and any other movie that has characters stuck in a time loop, even recently Palm Springs. But if you do it right in a way that can satisfy the audiences, you can surely get your point across and entertain. And I think this movie does a good job at that too. Kicking on that, the direction, writing, and the technical aspects as far as music, cinematography, and editing are all very top notch. It's an hour and 39 minutes. It gets you straight in and it gets you straight out. You're not really feeling any like you're bored or something. You don't even feel like that this movie is that convoluted. It has other subplots involving Catherine Newton's character, her mother is sick, and Mark and his friends. And I thought those other subplots were very interesting. It's very fun, and there was a lot of jokes and a lot of heartfelt sweetness to it that you just can't help but take in. I very much like what they were going for. I like the entertaining moments that this movie was trying to go for. And I very much respected the movie for doing that and for taking a risk. It's not many movies where you get to see risks being taken. And I felt like the movie did a good job at doing exactly what it needed to do on that front. So, it did do what it had to do. The only real sort of issue I do have, which is the only issue, is that it is a little bit familiar. It does get a little too sentimental for its own good in one plot of the movie. And I will say, of course, there is one little moment in here that I found myself being a little bit, okay, that was very cliche. But other than that, the tiny map of perfect things, I thought this was a very harmless, very entertaining, and very sweet and endearing romance sci-fi film. And I will give that an epitastic. Cherry, of course, was the follow-up for the Russo brothers after Avengers Endgame, or Avengers 4. And, of course, reuniting with Tom Holland, of course. And this movie is basically the wild journey of a disenfranchised young man from Ohio who meets the love of his life, only risks losing her through a series of bad decisions and challenging life circumstances. He starts doing money, he starts going to the army, comes addicted to opioids, to robbing banks to pay for the addiction. And a lot of people I've seen hate on this movie. And look, I'm not going to say this is their best outing, because the Russo brothers, they definitely have done better than this. They've done four consistently great comic book movies in a row. But I will say this is a decent film. First off, I would say Tom Holland does a good job in the role as Cherry. He does a very good job. He's based on the author of the book Cherry by Nico Walker, but he does a very good job in his performance. He's very likable, very charismatic, and he's very entertaining to watch. Tom Holland is very charismatic, and he's going to bring more of that charisma in No Way Home. Adding to that, you have Sierra Bravo as Emily, who I have not seen her since Big Time Rush, so it was great seeing her here again. You also had Jack Raynor, Michael Rispoli, Jeff Wahlberg, Michael Gandolfini, the son of James Gandolfini. You also had Thomas Lennon, Damon Wayans Jr., and of course, Kelly Berglund in the movie, who was surprised to see her. And the performances, I think, are really good. I will say Anthony and Joe Russo, they do a great job directing wise, and they both do a fantastic job in terms of the direction and what they do. This is also a very well shot film, a very well lit film, and this was a movie that was definitely something that very different from the other films. You could tell the Russos, they wanted to do something a little more different, a little more out there. And that's what I like about the Russo brothers. They want to do something more different as opposed to the big blockbuster MCU films. And I did find myself interested with this story. Of course, the movie is very well shot by Newton Thomas Seigel. You have a good score by Henry Jackman, and the good performances and direction does keep this movie afloat. This movie is, of course, a little bit too long, though. There are some things in this movie where I feel, some moments in this movie where I feel like the pacing does kind of drag a little bit, and it does kind of mess with this movie's length a little bit. It's great to see all these actors, like Kelly Berglund and such, but you could trim the fat a little bit from it. also, it's not the most fleshed out of characters, of course. The two main characters you do know, and some of the other characters, they do get their time to shine. But I will say there are some other characters who are just here just to be here. And I will say the movie does become a little too chaotic in terms of what he's doing. It's like we're jumping from an army guy to college guy to bank robbery guy to crazy drug addict and his girlfriend. But other than that, I will say the Cherry, this is definitely one of the better movies I've seen this year. It's not gonna be on my favorites of the year because I felt like the movie did need a bit more issues needing fixing and to fix some of the pacing. But Cherry, I will say this is not the Russo's worst film. I do think they do put as much effort as they should have. And I will say the movie definitely does go for what it really needs to go for. But Cherry, while it's not DeRusso's best film, I will say this is definitely a movie I can see myself watching again. But again, it's just those issues that does kind of hold this movie back for me. But I will say there's a lot more good than people are making this out to be. If you're a fan of Tom Holland or the Russo brothers, you can definitely watch this movie. It is definitely a movie I would recommend, but please be assured this movie does have a couple issues. So I will give Cherry, of course, a highly recommended. Stowaway is directed by Joe Pena, stars Anna Kendrick, Daniel Day-Kim, Shamir Anderson, and Toni Collette. This three-person crew on a mission to Mars to face an impossible choice when an unplanned passenger jeopardizes the life of everyone on board. This was a pretty decent sci-fi film. It's not the greatest thing ever. It's not the most amazing movie that you'll ever see, but I will say that this is a movie that I think is actually somewhat decent. Now, the cast is only four actors. You have Daniel Day-Kim, Anna Kendrick, Toni Collette, and Shamir Anderson. Anna Kendrick is a very capable actress. Everything she does is great. She is an Oscar nominee. She's also a very great singer, very talented. And she is very, very awesome in this movie as the medical researcher Zoe. Toni Collette, she's great in the role too as the ship commander. You also have Daniel Day-Kim as the ship biologist, and I think these three do really great in their performances. They each do phenomenal jobs with their casting, and of course everyone in this movie are very great in their roles. Daniel Shamir Anderson is the title stowaway and the plane engineer. And the sci-fi thriller aspects of this movie, it goes for it. It does go for the sci-fi thriller aspects that you want it to go to. And it does kick into high gear. There's great effects in here. The music and cinematography, I think, is very good. And there were moments while I was sitting here watching this and I found myself to be pretty scared, pretty filled with tension. So it definitely was something I didn't really expect. It knew exactly what it was trying to be. And it was very creepy when it comes to the thriller aspects. I found myself very intense, very scared, and there was one scene particularly involving Anna Kendrick where it's very tense, felt heavy, and I was sitting there like, oh my god. Granted, this is not the most original thing ever. It does have its issues when it comes to some of the stuff. I feel like some of the characters are not the greatest. And of course, I will say that this is a movie that I felt like definitely could have used a little bit more time with some of the characters. And when you get into the main thing involving this movie, some of it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. and I felt like it could have been a little clarified. And there was one or two moments where I felt like the movie needed to stop so we could have some character moments. But other than that, I thought Stowaway was a fairly decent watch. I don't think this is one of Netflix's best movies, but I don't think it's a bad movie. I just think this is very in the middle. It definitely has great performances, great cinematography, a good score by Juska. The editing I thought was very good. I liked the performances. And I liked the tension-filled moments. However, I will say, could have used a little bit more character development, and the movie could have been at least a little bit, just 5 minutes longer, because the movie is already an hour, it's 56 minutes, so it could have been a little bit shorter, but I thought it was fine, and I will say, you could stream this. Voyagers has to be, for me, one of the biggest wasted of potentials that 2021 had to offer. Coming from the director Neil Berger, who directed the first Divergent, very capable director, and starring a great cast of Ty Sheridan, Lily Rose Depp, Fiona Whitehead, and Colin Farrell, there is no reason why this movie shouldn't have been great. A crew of astronauts on a multi-generational mission descends to paranoia and madness, not knowing what is real or not. Or so they thought, as they face what's outside the ship or who they are becoming inside it. Again, this has to be for me, this is like you take the Lord of the Flies and the odyssey of 30 young men and women who are sent into a mission in search of a new home. It's basically Lord of the Flies, but in space. And that, I think, is an absolutely pretty good concept. I love the Lord of the Flies. Neil Berger is a great director. I liked Limitless, and I very much enjoyed the first Divergent. And I like this cast. Ty Sheridan, Lily Rose Depp, Fiona Whitehead, Colin Farrell, Quintessa Swindle. So, this easily for me has to be the most annoying film, because this movie, it starts off so well in the first act. It sets everything up, the rules and regulations are there. You get to spend time on this great trip, and this whole idea, I think, works very well for a concept. And I thought the performances, of course, Ty Sheridan, Lily Rose Depp, the daughter of Johnny Depp, Fiona Whitehead, and everyone else, including Colin Farrell and Shantae Adams. And the concept alone, I think, is very interesting, very awesome, and very intriguing. Also, the characters are falling in love with each other. They don't know what's going on with each other or not. They're experiencing weird, creative things. This part of the first act did set up the rules and regulations very well. It's a very well shot film, it's a very well lit film, a very well edited film, and the effects here are not the problem. This has good effects. You have a good musical score, of course, by Trevor Grekus. Great editing, of course, style in some moments. And this is very well, beautifully lit film. Great lighting effects by Eric Shediak. Some great production design. What hurts this movie for me, as well, when you get to the first act and the second act, the movie just goes downhill in the third act. The third act definitely ruins exactly what everything this movie goes for. There is a whole twist that I don't want to get into because it's very, very disappointing. I thought when you found out this whole twist and turns, I was sitting there like, you've got to be kidding me. This is one of the stupidest reveals of this entire movie. Not only that, to add to insult to injury, you also have some of the most lackluster characters I have seen. Like I said, the actors are great. They're not the problem at all. The problem I do have with this is the story and some of the decisions that this movie chooses to make. Some of the decisions with the characters and some of the story. You have this great idea of Lord of the Flies in space, and while for the most part, half of the time I'm sitting there most of this movie bored, most of the time, some of the character decisions and stuff isn't the most well thought out. And also, you have a lot of these weird, crazy shenanigans and scenarios in here that I just went like, oh, come on now, you're trying too hard. And I will say the dialogue in this movie is not the greatest. I felt someone should have written, also written this movie with Neil Berger. Because you need at least one more rewrite. Because when you get into some of the weird, horrifying stuff, it just goes into the most cliche territory. And it just basically doesn't work. Basically. But the first two acts are so good that when you get to this third act, the third act just basically ruins it. It might sound like I'm hating on this movie and ranting and raving on this movie. I'm not. I'm just more disappointed in the way they chose to do this. Granted, this is not going to be one of the worst movies of the year, but this is definitely in the category, in the top 5 for the most disappointing films of the year. I expected a lot more from this movie than I did, and I will say you could just rent this to Redbox or stream this. I'm this close to putting, saying stream this thing, because you have this great idea and this great concept, but it basically just doesn't do anything with it. The performances are great. I think the idea and the setup and the rules and regulations are great. I think there's a version of this movie where it could have been the best movie of the year or one of my favorites of the year. But at the end of the day, this is a decent but rather frustrating film. So I'm definitely gonna have to say you could stream this thing. Definitely expect a lot more from Voyagers than what we got. Without Remorse is another one of those movies where I think is decent, if a little frustrating. This is directed by Stefano Salima, who directed Sicario, Day of the Soldado. It is written by Taylor Sheridan, based on the book of the same name by Tom Clancy, and stars Michael B. Jordan, Jamie Bell, Jodie Turner-Smith, and Guy Pearce. Seeking justice for the murder of his pregnant wife, an elite Navy SEALs person uncovers a covert plot that threatens to engulf the United States and Russia into an all-out war. This is, of course, a spin-off of the Jack Ryan franchise with a completely new character named John Clark. This could have been something interesting, and it is a very interesting idea. First off, I will say Michael B. Jordan as the hero of the movie, he does a very good job in the movie. I think he's awesome, he's likable, he's badass, he's great in this role. He does the physical action scenes himself, and he's awesome in this movie. He's awesome. I like Michael B. Jordan, he does a great job in the role. Add to that, you have other actors like Jamie Bell, Jodie Turner-Smith, Luke Mitchell, Coleman Domingo, and Guy Pearce. I think they all do a very good job. And this movie, of course, is one of those victims that was in development hell. So for the what we got here, it's a very serviceable little action movie with Michael B. Jordan. And I very much liked, of course, what the movie was trying to do. The action scenes are very well shot. You can see what's going on. And you definitely do love a lot of the action scenes. It's very well shot. It's not shaky cam. It's not quick cuts, quick editing, all over the place. And camera-wise, cinematography-wise, it's a very good-looking movie. And I do like the score of the film. And is a well-edited movie for the most part, with good performances. Unfortunately, where I get into the frustrating parts is with the writing and more. First off, with the script. The script has good intentions here, but I don't think those expectations were very much met in some areas. I do like the character development, I do like the story, and I like some of the other decisions that the script chooses to make, but I feel like there are some aspects of this script where it just doesn't fully come together, or some things need a little more fleshed out or taken out of the script. And in most cases, taken out of the script. Because there is this whole plot, which I found to be a little bit far-fetched from itself and a little bit too out there for its own good, but I was still very much intrigued with what this idea was. But why I say far, it feels like it just feels like they just came up with it at the last minute. And I'm pretty sure this is also in the book that this is based off of, and I haven't read the books, so I don't know if it is or not. Also, I will say this movie has the biggest sin of being in development hell for so long that it definitely shows. Initially, at one point, this was supposed to be Keanu Reeves. This was also supposed to be Lawrence Fishburne and Gary Sinise, Kevin Costner, of course, Tom Hardy. And this, of course, was mainly years after the last movie, Jack Ryan's Shadow Recruits. And it definitely does show when it comes to this movie. Also, this movie also has the biggest sin of underutilizing some very likable actors here. You have, of course, Lauren London as the wife of Michael B. Jordan. It is good to see Lauren London in a movie like this, but what they do with her involving the killing, wow, that was just a waste. That was just a waste of Lauren London's awesome talents. Also, the villain in this movie is pretty damn generic. This has the most generic villain that honestly is not very well handled. Of course, his plot, his motivation, even the performance itself isn't all that interesting. And it's pretty sad considering the fact that this is a good action movie with a lackluster villain. Also, this movie is a little bit boring and predictable. Sometimes the movie is very slow-winded, and it could have picked up for some of the more draggy parts of the film. And of course, the movie definitely is very predictable in some spots, because you know where this is gonna go, you know how this is gonna end. And I felt like they could have added a little bit more twists and turns to make it less like that. I'm not saying you have to make it the greatest thing ever, but you could have at least take some liberties and took some risks with it. And ultimately, it didn't really do that as much as it should. But at the end of the day, without Remorse, I do think this is a very entertaining film. I think this is a very well done film with good action scenes, great direction, good performances and such. I just felt like the script and the villain and some of the slow parts could have been fixed in the editing room or with more script rewrites. And then I think this could have been another one of my favorites of the year. But so it's a decent watch, but a frustrating watch for sure. So that was the first half of the massive 2021 catch-up review series. I hope you all enjoyed this. This is gonna be a little shorter since this is at least the first 11 to 12 movies here that I saw. Next up, I will give you guys what I watched during the summer to August, and that will hopefully fill you in with some of the blanks. If I do have to add an extra film there, then I'll add it there. But let me know in the comments section down below what you guys think of each of these movies. Do you like them? Do you hate them? Or are you somewhere right in the middle? Please comment down below and let me know. Be sure to like this video, comment down below what you guys think of it, share this video, also hit that subscribe button and the notification bell to get notified when new videos like this are up. Otherwise, you will not get notifications to either one of those. Also, it does help with the algorithm and it does help with views on this channel. If you would like to send any money to my Cash App, you can email me or DM me privately to do so. My Amazon wish list is in the description box. If you would like to send me any fan mail, on my social media links are in the description box down below. I will see you guys for more reviews. Hopefully, I will get the rest of the other 2021 reviews, standalone reviews, out of the way. And as always, you guys keep it cool. Join the Epictasticness. I'll see you guys in November. I got a lot of stuff planned and some pre-recordings to do as far as the Matrix reviews and my worst movies of all time. I do have more videos that I've already done coming, and I very much appreciate you guys. Let's get this channel to 2k subscribers by December.